But I think the main threat will always come from an environment of cynicism, and the Prime Minister 2 days ago commented on it, which starts building up when you see poor quality of governance. It's then that people start getting disillusioned with the system. It's then that some element of negativism builds up. And I responded to that by an article yesterday where I said, the correct question to be asked is, why does negativism build up? And the answer is, it's only when we in governance fail the people. You give a great quality of governance, there is a great enthusiasm amongst people. But if people see inadequate governance in a country, and that's linked to your second subject of accountability, then comes a question, well, is this the right system? People start questioning the relevance of the system and its possible sustainability itself. Now, this is where the Indian governance and those involved in the polity of India have to realize. Let me tell you a challenge. The challenge is, the power of politics is immense. There is no substitute for politics. Politics influences the life of a nation. Politics determines policy. Politics finds its representation in parliament and state legislatures. And the power of politics is huge. It determines the direction a nation takes. So there is a logical expectation that in view of this power of politics, the stature and quality of men who man this polity must bear nexus to the power they wield. And I think that is where people get a sense of cynicism, when we find that the stature of those men doesn't measure up to the job and the responsibility that they have. And that is when we come to the question, how do we fix political accountability? Mr. Gupta, in his opening comments, raised a question that there is a recent issue of allocation of natural resources. Now, the big debate was, how do we allocate natural resources? Do we do it by a discretion? Do we do it by a transparent process? I've always been very clear in my mind. In India, where you have discretions, you will have more abuse of power than use of power. Therefore, one straightaway answer is, please eliminate discretions. Go back to the system of merit. Go back to an objective criteria where we are ruled by rules and not ruled by men. Therefore, you may have exceptional cases, and I think the Supreme Court in the reference opinion returned a very mature verdict where the Supreme Court said, if you are allocating a natural resource meant for commercial exploitation, so the wealth of the citizen, the wealth of the people, the wealth of the state gets transferred into private hands. And this is meant for commercial exploitation. So spectrum was not meant for charity, it was meant for commercial exploitation. Coal is not meant for charity, it is meant for commercial exploitation. So when it is meant for commercial exploitation, there must be a transparent and competitive bidding. So those who pay the state the maximum by a transparent process are the people who get it. The second object is, you don't transfer wealth of the state to the private citizen for a song. You charge what is the market quality. The market value is determined by the market itself. It can't be determined by somebody sitting in a mantralaya. Because again, you are bound to earn and there will be allegations. Therefore, the simple rule is, if a natural resource is meant for commercial exploitation and the resource of the state is being transferred to a person or a company for commercial exploitation, maximization of profit of the state, maximizing of the value, as also a competitive bidding, a transparent process must follow. There can be exceptions. And the exceptions can only be, there can be natural resources you need for livelihood. Water and air can't be optional. So that's an exception. That's a natural resource, can't be optional. But the spectrum in that air can be optional. The gas below the water in a sea can be optional. The petroleum below that, the crude oil before that, below that can be optional. The only other exception they've said is that if something is intended to be given for a social or welfare object. Now here the social welfare objects have to be very clearly defined. Your own professional educational institutions, you have to pay the institutional rates. One of the judges has made a very interesting comment. He says they can be given cheaply provided they are linked to the charges these institutions charge. So if the hospital is charging a huge amount, then perhaps it's not entitled to get land at a cheaper rate. Then you must pay what you charge your patients, so you must pay the state for your land. However, if you can say that I'll cap it, and that's a part of the agreement, that can be an exception. My only fear in breaching this rule of bidding and market value is linked to my first premise that we still need to improve the quality of people in governance. We need to improve their integrity levels and their accountability levels. And in a country like India, if you give the discretion to the state to deviate from the rule of competitive bidding and determine it on a case-to-case basis, then in all likelihood, the case-to-case basis, I said this in writing in an article, transforms itself into a suitcase-to-suitcase basis. And that opens the floodgates. Therefore, that is what requires to be prevented in a society like India. The second problem. There is a sudden decline, I find in the last two decades, in the nature and character of political parties in India. And this has direct relationship to the issue of accountability. We've seen the American system. Both the principal political parties have the primaries. There's a democratic system within the party by which you elect and decide who your leader will be for the presidential race. You've seen the grill that they are going through in the three national debates. And somebody lagging behind can just come up because he puts a better performance. So it's following the survival of the fittest rule. That's how democracies are run. In England, I remember about 2 years ago when Mr. David Cameron's Conservative Party took over, I was in London and I was speaking to some of the Labour MPs, and I said, what are you doing? He said, for 6 months after losing the election, we are all locked ourselves up and we are in an inner party process. It will take us 6 months to determine who our next leader will be. So there are party conferences, there are discussions, etc. Now what happened, unfortunately, in India in the last two decades, that there are only few structured parties left. And I blame all of us sitting here. The left parties are a structured party. My party, to a large extent, is a structured party. Most other political parties have transformed. They are controlled by a family. They are controlled by a person. The person normally is charismatic. He has the support of a caste or a group or a community behind. He eliminates all opposition within the party. And succession is on basis of what happens within the family. You will then find, and if you now look at the map of India, there are two principal parties in the Kashmir Valley. Punjab, Haryana, UP. Not Nitish Kumar, but it's a more structured party, but the earlier government which ruled there for 15 years. Not the left. Then you come down. The principal party in India is the crowd around the family. You go to Maharashtra, you go to Andhra Pradesh, you go to Tamil Nadu. So barring a few cases left, you can count them on one hand, on five fingers. So you now have parties led by charismatic people, they have a community support, there's a family control, all accounts remain within the family, the succession remains within the family. And we now have a complete replacement of meritocracy in India. Nobody knew of President Obama 2 years before he was elected. He made his impact in the campaign. And now the impact is that once you have this entire system, and unfortunately Indian mindsets have to change. They have to get out of this feudal psyche. The real strength of Indian democracy will emerge when merit replaces service. That's what I told you in the very beginning, and that's what I'm reiterating even in politics. It's happened in business. Those legendary families we used to name in the 60s and the 70s have been now overtaken. Who had heard of these Bangalore IT companies 20 years ago? Now this has to happen. And therefore, if we are a young popular country, if we are a country which is seeking to enlarge a human resource, we have to improve the quality of polity. Now the other danger is that if you have a captive support, then even corruption allegations can't detain you. UP is a living example. You have the two big parties in Uttar Pradesh, both facing similar allegations. One replaces the other and continues to be on the same track. They hold the balance of power at the center. And therefore, unless, and you'll find this directly impinging on the quality of governance in UP. Bihar managed to emerge slightly out of this, and you can see visible changes taking place. And I think, therefore, it's necessary now, it's for the people of India to realize. I always believe there's a very important quotation from a very well-known judge called Justice Learned Hand. He said, democracy lies in the hearts of men and women. When it dies there, no constitution, no law can save it. And therefore, people of India have to realize how long do we go by this feudal psyche of eulogizing surnames and families rather than merit and quality. And unless we introduce that merit and quality into Indian politics, the norms of accountability will remain farcical. Now if you come down to the next step, you need mechanisms in a society. Nobody in the United States thinks in terms of they have transparent political funding mechanisms. We don't. How Indian politics sustains is itself a question. I of course know the answer, but there is always a conspiracy of silence. We don't share that answer with people. If that's the plight of the world's largest democracy, then let's not have seminars on accountability, let's implement it. When I was the law minister, I introduced two changes in law, that corporates and individuals can now donate by check, and whatever they give by check, they'll get an income tax exemption. So we try to incentivize it.